Let me officially say good evening and welcome to all of you who are joining me this evening. My name is Magdalena Baczewska. I am connecting with you from New York City, and it is a wonderful pleasure to be back after quite some time. For some of you, you may remember our pandemic time lectures called The Enjoyment of Music, which we held during lockdown and a little bit after. And those lectures we held in two installments. One was for young audiences, age 4 to maybe 16, and the other part of the series was addressed to adults. And I have really, really fond memories of that time together and being able to learn from one another during the difficult time. And I'm very, very grateful to the Chopin Society of Atlanta for having me back. It is a very special occasion for the Chopin Society to have a recital by the bronze medalist of the Chopin International Piano Competition, Martín García García, a Spaniard who has trained both in Madrid as well as in New York. And I just want to share on a personal note that Martín and I have shared the same piano teacher, Jerome Rose, for a while. I, of course, was his student much earlier, and it is just so wonderful to have the same mentor who has not only helped us pianistically but also has been there for us, you know, helping us decide on big life's choices. Martin Garcia Garcia is also a first prize winner of the Cleveland Piano Competition. So 2021 was a very good year for Martin. And when he became third prize winner of the Chopin competition, he also received a special prize for the best performance of a concerto. And he is the first Spaniard to reach the final stage of the Chopin competition. His recital is going to take place on Saturday, March 11th at 7:30 p.m. I hope that you all have your calendars marked for that occasion. It's going to be at the Florence Kopleff Recital Hall at the Georgia State University. And all the information is on the Chopin Society's website. There's also a wonderful interview that Bożena Zaremba did with Martin, and I hope that you get a chance to check it out. Martin has very thoughtfully chosen the program for the recital. It's going to be works by Chopin and Schumann. And it is not accidental. A lot of his choices are not accidental, and I will talk about that a little bit more later on. I should maybe start by telling a little bit about the newcomers, about the relationship of Chopin and Schumann, because the two composers knew each other. So there is really no extensive evidence of a close friendship between the two composers. We know that they knew each other. It is also a possibility that some letters between the two may have been lost, because not all of the letters by Chopin survive. The two composers were born the same year, 1810, and they were both avid students and admirers of the music of Johann Sebastian Bach, as is actually Martin, as you will find out. Both Chopin and Schumann passionately studied Bach's collection of preludes and fugues, and I know that we probably have some piano students among us. Some of you may already be studying the preludes and fugues from the collection of Well-Tempered Clavier. And so Chopin and Schumann were both really learning from it all throughout their lives. However, the two composers were very different in their creative ways and really moved in separate circles. And I'd like to quote Anthony Tomasini of the New York Times, who wrote about the two composers the following: Chopin was a natural musician with such precocious talent as a pianist and improviser that he considered himself essentially self-taught. We know that Chopin did have teachers, but essentially their genius really lay in the fact that they allowed Chopin to develop on his own. They recognized his tremendous talent and they sort of stayed out of the way. And Tomasini continues, Schumann, on the other hand, was a bookish young man raised in a literary household where music was a rewarding amateur endeavor. Initially drawn to literature as much as music, he likened musical composition to a poetic activity. And you're going to see that over and over in his output, where there are literary and poetic influences and references in his piano pieces. In 1831, so both composers at that time are 21 years old, Schumann made a very important statement about Chopin that's going to sort of define Chopin's career. He writes in the Allgemeine Musikalische Zeitung, "Hats off, gentlemen, a genius." And this was the first review of Chopin's variations on the subject of Lacci darem la mano from Mozart's opera Don Giovanni. This was the opus 2 of Chopin, the second piece that he ever published. Not all pieces by Chopin were adored as much, and you will hear about it later. For example, the sonata that is actually on Martin's program was something that confused Schumann a little bit, and I'm going to read you some quotes later on. Anyway, Chopin and Schumann met twice. The first time was in 1835 when Chopin stopped briefly in Leipzig on the way to meet with his parents in Karlsbad. Schumann was completely starstruck by Chopin. He thought it was just the greatest composer. Chopin was either not as warm, or possibly the letters or the diary entries may have been lost, but we don't have any evidence of Chopin being as delighted with Schumann's presence or his music for that matter. And we know that Chopin notoriously misspelled Schumann's music, adding another H to it. The two composers had a kind of courteous relationship, very cordial, dedicating various works of music to each other. So, for example, Schumann's Kreisleriana, Opus 16, is dedicated to my friend, Mr. Frédéric Chopin. On the other hand, when Chopin published his ballad in F major, Opus 38, he dedicated it to Mr. Robert Schumann. So you can see that there is a slight, very delicate difference between my dear friend and simply Mr. Robert Schumann. We do not know whether Chopin ever played Schumann's music. There are no accounts of it. So the likelihood is that Chopin never did that, and neither did he recommend that his students study Schumann's music. But let's move on to the program itself now. So Martin has chosen to start with Chopin's Mazurkas, Opus 33. And mazurkas, as some of you may already know, are these short gems of piano literature. Chopin wrote nearly 60 of them, and he wrote mazurkas throughout his life. In fact, his last piece that Chopin wrote on his deathbed is a mazurka. For somebody who grew up in Poland but left at age 20, never to be able to return to his motherland, this is a very big statement. He is missing home all the time and writing with this nostalgia, with this homesickness. Even though he by then is very respected in the Parisian society, he is still writing pieces that remind him of home and that are this kind of manifestation of being Polish, or the national pride. We should also keep in mind that at that time, Poland doesn't really exist on the map of Europe. It had been partitioned by the three powers, Russia, Prussia, and Austria. Let me share with you a quick performance by Arthur Rubinstein of the first of in this cycle of these mazurkas. I'm going to share my screen. So this first mazurka is, as you see, is rather slow. It's full of melancholy. And I'd like you just to think of this as Chopin's kind of recollection of the good old days at home. Let me share screen. I'll have to stop right here because we have so much to discuss. You will probably, you are, for those of you who are great lovers of the music of Chopin, you are already used to his idiom where the right hand assumes the role of the singer and is just tremendously lyrical in its expression. What we should remember is that mazurkas are actually dances. They are inspired by country dances, folk dances in Poland, and they already originated in Poland in the 16th century and later became very popular with the nobility. But they always retained their kind of folk atmosphere. So they had a kind of a double life, living in ballrooms on one hand, in Russia, Germany, England, and France on the other, always kind of sort of going back to their folk origins. And here I'd like to share the second mazurka with you. It's quite different. It's of that much more lively variety. In fact, in Polish, it even has its own name. It's Oberek. And it's alludes to the spinning of the dance partner. It is it's a couple dance, so the partners spin and jump, and there's just a lot of merrymaking. Let's hear the second mazurka. Here, I'm going to stop right here. So you can even hear in the melody and these very ornamented gestures that Chopin is alluding to the twirling of the dancers. Another really interesting thing about Chopin's mazurkas is that although they sound like folk music to the ears of Polish people, they actually are original melodies. So Chopin only borrowed the character of this music, but didn't actually quote any particular piece. So they're completely original. Let me share number three, just a few seconds of it with you. Again, it shows a great contrast. So this one is in a simple key of C major, and it sounds like just this lovely, intimate melody. But let me throw this quote into the story. This is a quote by Robert Schumann, again. And he writes something very, very powerful about the mazurkas. He says, "If the mighty monarch of the North," and that means the Russian Tsar, "knew what dangerous foe was threatening him in these utterly simple mazurka melodies, he would doubtlessly ban this music. The works of Chopin are canons concealed among flowers. This is another a very famous quote about Chopin's music. And again, it comes from Robert Schumann. So in a way, this music also functions as a protest music. And let's hear how Chopin conceals his canons among flowers. So as you see, as you hear rather, on the surface, this music is just very pleasant and light and entertaining. At the same time, Chopin is expressing something very powerful, that the existence of his nation despite the lack of it on the maps of Europe. And here is just a fragment of the fourth mazurka, opus 33, played by Arturo Benedetti Michelangeli here. And I will let you decide on which variety of the mazurka it is, whether it is the slow kujawiak or the quick and twirling oberek. So you see, Chopin can be also quite mysterious here, and his pieces are hardly ever just one thing. As you continue listening, and you will appreciate that in the live performance of Martin's, that Chopin is able to change moods on a dime. And the middle sections of the piece often reveal this very, very stormy character. So listen for that. A lot of the times, the form of these mazurkas is ABA. So you're going to hear maybe a calm, nostalgic melody, but then there will be a storm inside, and a lot of Chopin's music sort of reveals that kind of thing. All right, then we move on to the Barcarolle, Barcarolle Opus 60. It's a very unusual piece for Chopin. He only writes one of those. The Barcarolle comes from the Italian word barca, the meaning literally the boat. And it is now one of the two most celebrated barcarolles in the musical literature, the other one being by Offenbach. And I actually want to share with you the video of that beautiful vocal piece. Chopin would not have known it because it is written after Chopin's death. But there are a few elements that are very characteristic to the barcarolle, namely the rocking rhythm. So you're going to always hear the barcarolle in six, in one, two, three, four, five, six. So it is really actually a big two. So one, two, and it feels just always gently rocking. What it also alludes to is the Venetian gondoliers songs. So for those of you who may have been lucky enough to have been to Venice, you may recall that the operators of the gondolas are actually often singing in a duet, and this kind of singing is imitated here by Jacques Offenbach. Let's just hear a small fragment of it. So pay attention to the rocking melody, and then you're going to hear the second voice coming in. 122. I won't play from the beginning. Let's just start right here. I'm going to stop here. It is such delightful music. And I actually want to take this opportunity right now to promise you that I will send all the links from today's presentation to Dorota Lato, who will then share them with you. I think it will be nice to hear these pieces in their entirety, either before the concert or just anytime. And so here comes Chopin's own barcarolle. As you could now hear, we have this gentle rocking rhythm. We're in just gentle six. And this is what Chopin does with that concept. This is Polish pianist Christian Zimmermann, who himself became a winner of the Chopin competition in Warsaw back in 1980. I will stop here. As you see, this piece is nearly 10 minutes long. It's a really monumental journey, but it is a very joyful one, but also full of variety. You're going to be taken through the various landscapes in this music. But what I really want you to appreciate in Martin's recital is how beautifully Chopin writes for the right hand, how he basically turns it into the two singers always in a duet with one another. It's a great skill to be able to play this way. And I am sure that Martin's performance will be just fabulous. He will then move to the preludes by Chopin. This whole first half is the music of Chopin. Chopin wrote 24 preludes in a cycle, which he published as Opus 28. He was 29 years old when he wrote them, and it was in Valdemosa in Mallorca, Spain, where he, with his partner, Georges Sand, escaped the damp cold weather of Paris. As you may know, Chopin was always in a bad health. Some even say that he was essentially dying all of his life. He died of tuberculosis, and he always had trouble with his health. So in an effort to make to improve his state, it was decided that he should experience the Spanish weather in March. However, it actually turned out to be an awfully damp and rainy period, and Chopin may have even returned more sick than he than when he went there. As he was there, his piano had finally arrived, because he had his piano shipped from Paris. He was able to compose these preludes. And I should also add that composing for Chopin was not an easy thing. It was not a 1-2-3. He suffered a lot. He crossed out a lot. He experienced a lot of frustration with his writing. In this case here of the preludes, Opus 28, Chopin is clearly paying homage to Johann Sebastian Bach by the sheer number of the preludes, 24, being written in all major and minor keys. He's literally alluding to the well-tempered clavier, to this collection of Bach's preludes and fugues. We know that he had a copy of it with him in Mallorca. And Martin here will choose actually just 4 out of the 24. And this is something that Chopin himself would have done. Apparently, Chopin was never heard playing more than 4 out of the cycle. These days, a lot of pianists opt to play the entire work, which works super well, and it's an incredibly emotional journey. I'm going to share with you just the 2 out of the 4. Something to think about. You know, Chopin wrote this very imaginative music that's very evocative. It describes so many emotions, but yet Chopin had this real dislike for big names and calling his pieces these grand descriptive titles. You know, while his contemporary Liszt, for example, was writing Mephisto Waltz, so these pieces really evoking poetry and literature, Chopin opted for simple titles such as preludes, right? So let me now share with you prelude number 2 and prelude number 14, and I'll tell you the reason why I'm doing this. After the preludes, Martin will perform the piano sonata number 2 of Chopin, and there is something so similar about this prelude number 2 and 14 to the funeral march of the sonata, as well as this last movement. And I think you will know exactly what I mean. Just try to absorb as much of this music as you can, so you can remember and then enjoy the similarities. So this is the queen of piano, Marta Argerich, who won the Chopin competition in 1965. Just a short fragment of her playing prelude number 2. It sounds very somber, almost like a funeral march. Let's listen. going to stop right here. As you see, it is not as melodious as the mazurkas which we heard before. It almost seems like the aim of the piece is to introduce some of the grotesque, maybe kind of a less groomed reality, if you will. So keep that one in mind, because it will be very similar to that funeral march from later on. And then here is not even 30 seconds of music, prelude number 14, E flat minor. You will hear it essentially howling in this most dissonant and almost unpleasant to the ear way, which is not something that we associate very easily with the music of Chopin. Just listen to how strange this prelude sounds. That is it. It was very strange about this piece is that it is basically played by both hands that are doing the same thing. So it is very different from the majority of music by Chopin, where the right hand gets to be the singer and the left hand accompanies. In this case, both hands are doing the same thing, and it is very dissonant and very chromatic, really signifying struggle and darkness. And more of that to come. So here is Chopin's Sonata number 2 in B flat minor, opus 35. It was written by Chopin when he was 30 years old. He wrote it in Noyon, France, again, while living with his partner, Georges Sand. Georges Sand had a very special relationship with Chopin. She was quite a bit older than him, and in a way, she provided this motherly care for Chopin. Some say that thanks to her, Chopin lived as long as he did, and it was only 39 years. So here is the sonata. It was not written from the beginning. It was actually conceived starting with the funeral march. I'm going to play it for you from the beginning, though, so that you get the whole trajectory. In this piece, Chopin seems to be clearly thinking about late Beethoven's music, in particular his sonata opus 111. I'm not going to play it here because we have so little time together, but there are many similarities between this very stormy, dark nature of Beethoven's late work, the last piano sonata, and this piece here by Chopin. Let's just listen to the beginning and this extremely agitated, frantic opening theme. It's going to be preceded by a bell-like introduction. And here is Sergei Rachmaninoff, who most of you may know as a composer, but here he is actually playing the music of Chopin, which he revered. So you will hear these waves of emotions that where the piano goes from whispering to shrieking with despair. In the second movement of the piece, and I will share it from the same recording as you, you're going to hear what's called a scherzo. And for any of you who have played scherzos in the past, a scherzo literally means a joke in Italian. Well, there's nothing funny about this scherzo, and there is nothing funny about most scherzos that Chopin composed, except for maybe one, which is the number four. And there is something very sarcastic and very dark about Chopin's scherzo. So you're going to hear these insistent repeated octaves, which just gives us chills all over. This recording, by the way, you may hear that it may be technically of a slightly lower quality because it is a historical recording, but I'm sharing it with you because of its tremendous artistic value. And I will stop here. As I mentioned before, Chopin's music is never really one thing. So within this scherzo, you're going to hear this absolutely heavenly middle section where, you know, one just wonder how one could travel from such depths of darkness to this gorgeous sort of serene melody. And Martin does it so, so very well. For those of you who had a chance to watch him during the Chopin competition, you will know exactly what I mean. I believe that a lot of the recordings, but probably all of them, are still available on YouTube. Now comes the centerpiece of this sonata, and this is the funeral march. As I mentioned, Chopin did not like the descriptive titles, and so he simply just called it March. It was written 2 years before, and it became a piece that was played often and orchestrated and rearranged for different instruments. This piece was actually even performed at Chopin's own funeral. It was an arrangement. Let's listen. Many of you may already be very familiar with this funeral march. Just stop here. The march becomes more intense as it goes along. And now you will probably see and hear the similarity between this march and the prelude that I had just shared before, the prelude number two. It has that similar texture where the left hand seems to be that funeral procession, sort of carrying the coffin, and the right hand's melody is actually not at all very melodious. And for somebody like Chopin, who could write melodies that are truly heavenly, this is actually something very deliberate to limit himself to a melody that is extremely conjunct and extremely tight. Now, the final movement is probably the strangest, the weirdest, most bizarre pieces that Chopin ever wrote. And it is quite similar to, as you will hear, the prelude number 14. And that's where I really applaud Martin for his very clever programming decisions. Chopin wrote about this movement here: "The left hand and the right hand gossip in unison," meaning they play the same material, "after the march. Anton Rubinstein famously described this movement as the wind howling over the graves," which is so fitting given that we had just come from a funeral march. Let's just listen to it. you will agree with me that this piece is very bizarre. Robert Schumann, as I mentioned at the beginning, was rather confused by this whole thing. He described the sonata as four of Chopin's maddest children under the same roof. The last movement, which you just heard a fragment of, he described that it seems more like a mockery than any sort of music. So again, Chopin, who is very fluent in the art of heavenly melody, must have really gone for a certain effect here. But again, it was not accepted by all composers. Felix Mendelssohn, a famous romantic composer of the time, also said, when asked about this, about his opinion of the sonata, he says, "Oh, I abhor it." So it wasn't always that the Opus 35 was adored by the audiences. I'm going to get out of sharing here for a moment. So this is a very substantial first half of the program. Following that, you will hear solely the music of Robert Schumann. So as I mentioned, a contemporary of Chopin, a great admirer of Chopin. But as Anthony Tomasini already mentioned, he was this bookish type who always had a literature on his mind when writing. And these fantastic pieces, the Fantasiestücke, Opus 111, were written in 1851. We know that Schumann's wife, Clara, who in her own right was a terrific pianist and virtuoso as well as a composer, she wrote in her diary, "Robert has composed three piano pieces of a very serious, passionate character, which greatly pleases me." So again, Fantasiestücke, the fantastic pieces, the fantasy in this word suggests a great deal of imagination, both literary and pianistic. And these pieces fall into the category of character pieces, so short instrumental works that stand as self-contained units and with an evocative title, usually just conveying a specific idea or emotion. So here, Schumann gives into his fantasy, and we're going to just hear a tiny bit of each. And again, this is Opus 111. Could it be a coincidence that Schumann is again alluding to the seriousness of Beethoven's sonata under the same opus number 111? And the sonata, which we just heard, as I mentioned before, is also an allusion to Opus 111. So I think that Martin had a very, very clever idea of pairing these three pieces together. Let's take a quick listen. I'm going to share my screen. So as you hear, it's again highly chromatic, very passionate music, to be contrasted with just a few minutes later, when in the second movement, very calm, poetic, and meditative. So as you hear, the contrast couldn't be greater. We have this very passionate, revolutionary opening and a calm and meditative second movement. You may know or not about Robert Schumann that he often described in his own writing, and he wrote a lot, as I say, he's a literary type. He often mentioned two characters, two personages, of that of Eusebius and Florestan. These were two made-up characters that lived in his imagination. And they were exactly that. Eusebius was the philosopher, an introvert type, and Florestan was the very opposite. He was the romantic and passionate, rash kind of individual. And those two always converse in Schumann's head. For those who are interested in modern psychiatry, Schumann these days would have been actually diagnosed with the manic depressive disorder or bipolar disorder. And so actually these two characters really give us sort of a clue as to how he thought and how he created. And we know he, because he wrote in letters to his wife Clara, that there were periods where he simply couldn't write quickly enough because the ideas were chasing in his head, and he was just so extremely prolific and creative. And then there were these other moments of great depression. If you may know that Schumann's life really ended in tragedy, he attempted suicide by throwing himself into the River Rhine. While he was rescued, he never fully recovered, and he spent the rest of his life in an institution where he wasn't even at some point allowed to be visited by his wife Clara, because it would have made him too emotional. So this is a life full of storm and tragedy, and yet his imagination, his music is just so rich. Martin will conclude his recital with an incredible, huge cycle called Symphonic Etudes. How on earth, and let me just stop sharing for a moment, how on earth does one call a piano piece Symphonic Etudes? Symphonic means for the orchestra. So what could Schumann actually be thinking when writing this piano piece and thinking about symphonic connotations? Well, it is possible that what he simply meant was the colors, the expression of colors that the piano is capable of. Sometimes, I believe it was Arthur Rubinstein who said that piano is not one instrument, it is 100 instruments, it is an entire orchestra. So maybe that's what the word symphonic actually alludes to. And the word etude, for something that is a, you know, monumental work, a piece of music, to call it an etude, it's rather a strange choice, because what an etude actually means, and many of you know that from studying etudes yourselves, is that it means an exercise, a study. But then again, Schumann may have been inspired by the etudes of Chopin. And Chopin really was the first composer who brought the etudes from the status of a mere exercise to a gem that deserves attention on the concert stage. So again, I think Martin is very cleverly tying the program together to pay homage to Chopin through the music of Schumann. I'm going to, since we're running out of time, and I do want to take a few moments for questions, if there are any, let me just play the opening of these symphonic etudes by Schumann here, as played by Radu Lupu. So here too, you hear those two personages of Eusebius and Florestan. You just heard Eusebius. And let me play the last moment of the piece here, where you will hear the great passion of Florestan. And as you see, even on this video, the piece is over 30 minutes long, so it's a monumental form. Magnificent ending to an evening of music. And before I take any questions from you, I just wanted to also direct your attention to a wonderful interview that lives on the Chopin Society's website with Bożena Zaremba, who interviewed Martin. And let me just read a quote that caught my eye. Martin says, "Music is the only tool I have to share transcendence with other people. Somebody who is religious, for example, can get that transcendence through religion. But music is more than that," says Martin. "It encompasses humanity. It's about an individual, not about some dogma that some people believe in and some don't. Music allows us to share this transcendence with every person who listens." And so I certainly hope you'll be there in the audience listening to Martin and having that musical conversation with him. Thank you very much for listening. And I believe that the chat and the pre-concert lecture will also live on the Chopin Society's website. So if you have friends who weren't able to make it tonight, do let them know to look for this video later on. And I certainly very, very much hope that you enjoy Martin's recital. It's a wonderful opportunity. And we're so grateful to the Chopin Society for bringing this great artist to Atlanta. So for now, thank you again, and I wish you all a wonderful evening. Thank you, Nico, and thank you all of you. Take care. Good night.